With you, I am rarely quiet with you, because you rarely express anything to me. I would be more quiet if you were less so. Less expressive if you were more so.
The same old quarrel, the same for the last 15 years. That's because you are you and I am I. I suppose it shall go on forever. I shall go on being silent and you...
I suppose I shall go on talking. But it really doesn't matter, the silence or the talk. If we had something to be silent about or talk about, something in common, that's the point.
Do you really think we have nothing in common? We both like F. Scott Fitzgerald and prefer Burgundy to Champagne.
Our tastes and our vices are remarkably congenial, but our souls do not touch.
Our souls? Why should they? Every soul is lonely.
Yes, but doesn't want to be. The soul desires to find something into which to fuse, and so lose its loneliness. This hope to lose the soul's loneliness by union is love. It is the essence of love as it is of religion.
Deacon, you are growing more holy every day. Will drive me to drink.
That will only complete the list.
Well, I suppose we may be more congenial, for in spite of what you say, our vices haven't exactly matched. You're ahead of me on the drink.
Yes, and you on some other things. But perhaps I can catch up too.
Oh, perhaps. If you really give all your time to it. Like you did last winter, for instance. But I doubt I can ever equal your record.
I can never equal your record in the soul's infidelities.
Well, do you expect my soul to be faithful when you keep hitting it with a gridiron?
No, I do not expect it of you. I have about given up the hope that you will ever respond to either my ideas about household and children or about our personal relations. You seem to want as little as possible of the things that I want much. I harass you by insisting. You anger and exasperate me by retreating. We were fools not to have separated long ago.
Again, how you do repeat yourself, my dear.
Yes, I am very weak. In spite of my better judgment, I have loved you. But this time I mean it.
I don't believe you do. You never mean half the things you say.
I do this time. This affair of yours with Hank is on my nerves. It is real spiritual infidelity. When you are interested in him, you lose all interest in the household, the children, and me. It is my duty to separate.
Oh, nonsense! I didn't separate from you when you were running after that widow last winter. Spending hours with her every day, dining with her, and leaving me all alone. Telling me she was the only woman who had ever understood you.
I did not run after the widow, or any other woman, except you. They ran after me.
Oh, of course. Just the same since Adam. Not one of you had spirit to run after the apple himself. No, they ran after you. But you didn't run away very fast, did you?
Why should I, when I wanted them to take possession if they could? I think I showed splendid spirit in running after you. Not more than a dozen other men show the same spirit. It is true, as you say, that other women understand and sympathize with me. They all do, except you. I have never been able to be essentially unfaithful. You are abler in that regard.
I don't think so. I may have liked other people, but I never dreamed of marrying anyone. No, and I never thought any of them understood me, either. I took very good care that they shouldn't.
Why, it was only the other day that you said Hank understood you better than I ever could. You said I was too virtuous.
As usual, you misquote me. What I said was that Hank and I were more alike. And that you were a virtuous stranger, sort of wandering John the Baptist, preaching in the wilderness.
Preachers don't do the things that I
do. Oh, don't they?
Well, I know I'm as vicious as a man can be. You would see that if you loved me. I am fully as bad as Hank.
Hank doesn't pretend to be virtuous, so maybe you're worse. But I think you ought to make up your mind whether you're virtuous or vicious, and not assume to be both.
I am both, as a matter of fact, like everybody else. I am not a hypocrite. I love the vicious, and I love the virtuous and also the vicious. But I don't like being left out in the cold when you are having an affair. When you are interested in the other, you are not in me.
Why do you pretend to fuss about lamps and such things when you are simply jealous? I call that hypocritical. You know, I wish it were possible for man to play fair. But what you want is to censor and control me. while you feel perfectly free to amuse yourself in every possible way.
I am never jealous without cause, and you are. You object to my friendly and physical intimacies, and then expect me not to be jealous of your soul's infidelities when you lose all feeling for me. I am tired of it. It is a fundamental misunderstanding, and we ought to separate at once.
Very well, if you're so keen on it. But remember, you suggested it. I never said I wanted to separate from you. If I had, I wouldn't be here now.
No, because I have given all I had to you. I have nourished you with my love. You have harassed and destroyed me. I am no good because of you anymore. You have made me work over you to the degree that I have no real life. You have enslaved me. You are the devil who never really meant to harm, but sneers at desires and never wants to satisfy. Let us separate. You are my only enemy.
Well, you know we're told to love our enemies.
I have done my full duty in that respect. People we love are the only ones who can hurt us. They are our enemies unless they love us in return.
A man's enemies are those of his own household. Yes, especially if they love. You, on account of your love for me, have tyrannized over me, bothered me, badgered me, nagged me for 15 years. You've crushed my soul, which longs for serenity and peace, with your perpetual complaining.
Too bad. Perpetual complaining?
Yes, of course. But you see, my dear, I'm more philosophical than you, and I recognize all of this as necessity. Men and women are natural enemies, like cat and dog, only more so. They're forced to live together for a time when this wonderful race cannot go on. In addition, in order to have the best children, men and women of totally opposite temperaments must live together. Well, we have fulfilled our fate and produced our children, and they're good ones, but really, to also expect to live in peace together, we as different as fire and water, sea and land, that's too much.
If your philosophy is correct, that is another argument for separation. If we have done our job together, let us go on our ways and try to do something else separately.
Perfectly logical. Perhaps it would be best. But no divorce, that's so commonplace.
I find divorce no more commonplace than real infidelity.
Both are matters of every day. But I see no reason for divorce unless one of the spouses wants to marry again. I will never divorce you. If you want to marry again, you can divorce me.
As usual, you want to see me as a brute. I do not accept your philosophy. Children are the results of love, not because of it. Love should go on. It does go on. If once there has been the right relations, it is not remarrying or the unconscious desire for further propagation that moves me, but that eternal need for that peculiar sympathy which has never been satisfied. To die without that is failure to what appeals most to the imagination of human beings.
That is precisely the great illusion. That is the unattainable which lures us on and which will lead you, I foresee, if you leave me, to the arms of some other woman.
Illusion? Precisely what is you call illusion? Only there do we find truth. And certainly I am bitten badly by illusion or truth, whichever it is. It is truth to me. But I fear it may be too late. I fear the other woman is impossible.
I cannot comprehend this wild, swooning desire to wallow in unbridled unity. I was quoting her favorite philosopher. But as to being too late, no. You are more attractive than you ever. That shows your ingratitude to me, for I'm sure I've been a liberal education to you. You will easily find someone to adore you and console you for your sufferings with me, but do be careful this time. Get a good housekeeper.
And you are more attractive than you ever were. I can see the others see that. I have been a liberal education to you too.
I saw you as something very beautiful, very fine and sensitive, more understanding than anyone I'd ever known. More feeling. I still see you that way. From a great distance.
Distance?
Don't Don't you feel how far away from one another you are?
I have felt it, as you know. More and more so, that you've been pushing me more and more away and seeking more and more somebody, something else. But this is the first time you have admitted feeling it.
Yes, I didn't want to admit it. But now I see it has gone very far. It is though on opposite banks of a stream that grows wider.
Yes.
You have gone your way and I mine. There's a gulf between us.
Now you see what I mean.
Yes, that we ought to separate. That we are separated. And yet I love you.
Two people may love intensely and yet not be able to live together. It is too painful for you, for me.
We've hurt one another too much.
We have destroyed one another. We are enemies.
I don't understand it. How we've come to this. After our long life together, have you forgotten all of that? What wonderful companions we were. How gaily we took life with both hands. How we played with it and with one another. At least we have the past.
The past is bitter because the present is bitter.
You wrong the past.
The past is always judged by the present. Dante once said, "The worst hell is in present misery to remember former happiness."
Dante was a man and a poet and so ungrateful to life. Our past to me is wonderful and will remain so.
That is because our life together has been for you an episode.
No, it's because I take life as it is, not asking too much of it, not asking that any person or relation be perfect. But you are an idealist. You can never be content with what it... You have the poison. The longing for perfection in your soul.
No, not for perfection, but for you. Other people have it who do not love as much as we do. No work of art is right, no matter how wonderful the materials and the parts. If the whole, the unity, is not there.
But that's just what I mean. You've wanted to treat our relation and me as clay, and model it to the form that you saw in your imagination. You've been a passionate artist, but life is not a plastic material. It models us.
You are right. I have had the egotism of the artist, directed to a material that cannot be formed. I must let go of you and satisfy my need of union, of marriage.
Yes, but you cannot do that by seeking another woman. You would experience the same illusion. The same disillusion.
How then can I satisfy my mystic need?
That is between you and your God, whom I know nothing about.
If I could have stripped you of your divinity and saw it elsewhere, in religion, in work, with the same intensity that I saw it in you, we would not have needed this separation.
And we should have been very happy together.
Yes, as interesting changes.
Exactly. The only sensible way for two fully grown people to be together. And that's wonderful, too. Think, to have been together for 15 years and to never bore one another. To still be for one another the most interesting persons in the world. How many married people can say that? I've never bored you, have I, Deacon?
You have harassed, plagued, maddened, tortured me. Bored me? No, never, you bewitching devil.
I've always adored the poet and the mystic in you, though you've almost driven me crazy, you man of God.
And I have always adored the woman in you, the mysterious, the beckoning, and the flight that I cannot possess.
Can't you get God a while and come away with me?
Yes, darling. After all, you're one of God's creatures.
Faithful to the end. A truce then shall it be. An armed truce.
Yes, in a trice.